All right, Merry Christmas, everybody.
Merry Christmas.
I guess it doesn't matter if we're celebrating his conception or his birth today. Regardless, it's the same beautiful gift that we all can receive or not, and it's perfect. So I was going to continue with my my conversation about 10 reasons why it's young Earth versus old Earth, and I put that off because two reasons. One, Linda was harping on me to do something more Christmassy, and I sort of bowed to that, and I do have something I was going to read, but if I get to it, I get to it. If I don't, I don't, and that's okay. What am I reading anyhow, first of all?
Psalm 4.
Psalm 4. Psalm 4. The safety of the faithful. To the chief musician, with stringed instruments, a psalm of David. Hear me when I call, O God of my righteousness. You have relieved me in my distress. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer. How long, O you sons of men, will you turn my glory to shame? How long will you love worthlessness and seek falsehood? Selah. But know that the Lord has set apart for himself him who is godly. The Lord will hear when I call to him. Be angry and do not sin. Meditate within your hearts on your bed and be still. Selah. Offer the sacrifices of righteousness and put your trust in the Lord. There are many who say, who will show us any good? Lord, lift up the light of your countenance upon us. You have put gladness in my heart more than in the season that their grain and wine increased. I will both lie down in peace and sleep. For you alone, O Lord, will make me dwell in safety. Which, as with everything that we can read out of this book, is pertinent to what I'm about to talk about today, which is sort of Christmassy, sort of not. But I went to see Paul yesterday, and Paul said that he'd be watching. So I know you're out there, Paul. Hey. And this whole weekend has been a complete dichotomy of what we are all asked to do as Christians. So I'll start with this morning and work my way backwards to yesterday with Paul. And as Linda and a few of you know, there's a gal that I've met on my bicycling every morning, and she's not a Christian. And every year or so, I try and plug the concept to her, and she has nothing at all good to say about it. So I was toying with the idea of doing it today, and lo and behold, she opened up the door for me to do it. And she was talking today about one of her friends came over, and they're both well into their 80s, and you know, one was saying, well, you know, I'm not sure how much time I got left, or and like what I'm going to do, and if I go first, you do this, and if you go first, I'll do that, and like, you know. And so I started off, I just said, so what do you think happens after you die? And she said, well, I'm going to be someplace beautiful, and as the sun was coming up, she goes, and it's going to look like that every day. And I go, okay, how do you know that? And she goes, I just know it. And I said, based on what? What's going to get you there? What's what? Yeah, tell me about it. So she goes, oh, I guess you're going to start telling me all about this God stuff that you were doing. I'm like, so I spelled it out to her, and at every comma and period of my statement, she had something to refute it. And I'm like, okay, that's fine. I said, then I'm not going to argue with you, because for the first 49 years of my life, that's exactly what I thought. So I'm not going to argue with you. I'm just going to tell you there's something else and you need to know about it. And she's like, fine, Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas to you too. It's like, I thought you didn't believe in this stuff. Anyhow, so that was my total fail today, this morning. But yesterday, I went to see Paul and Elaine, and I got there, and I told him the day before that I was coming around noon, and, you know, Paul's a slender man to start off with, and he's even more slender now, and the hospice nurse was there, and he was kind of going through things with him, and I had a chance to chat with Elaine for a while, and so they were getting, talking about logistics, about, you know, safely moving Paul from one place to the other and taking care of business that you would have to do during the course of the day, and so Elaine and the nurse went into the room to discuss how they were going to take care of things going forward. So that left me and Paul. So I said to Paul, I said, so how are you doing? He goes, oh, you know, not that well. And he goes, it's not going to be long. And I said, but we know where you're going. And we know it's guaranteed. And he goes, absolutely. And I said, we all get fretful when you're about to cross the threshold. You know, we know it's over there, but, you know, there's that threshold. I have to actually step from here to there to do it. And it's like, yeah, that's the anxiety. I mean, you know, nobody's come back to tell us how that went, and we don't know. And so, but, you know, I said, it's promised, and we have no doubts about that. And he said, I know. And I said, great. So I said, but really, when you stop and think about it, everyone here has been through it, something similar to that once before. And when we first started to form, we were in our mother's womb, and we're sitting there going, okay, this is great. I'm comfortable here. And next thing you know, all these muscles are starting to push on you, and, like, you know, you're heading towards someplace you don't even know where you're going. And next thing you're out, all this light and sound that you've never seen before is around you. You're crying, you're upset, and here we are years later, and we're happy. So it's another transformation that has to do it. And tying the two stories together, it's like, you know, first of all, Paul, he's always been, since my last 10, 12 years of knowing him, has been somebody of great respect for me, and somebody whom I wish or hope someday that I'll be as strong a Christian as he is. And then you've got Marie, who's, like, lost. And it's like, okay, how do you approach that threshold with that same anxiety that we're all going to have, but having that knowledge, that proof, that guarantee, that word, that everything that is just pointing, just trust me, no fear, no pain, new bodies, off we go. So I guess the charge that we have all been given is to continually tell people about that. And this is the greatest season of all, because we're, again, whether we're celebrating his conception or his birth, it's still that same gift that all you have to do is say, I accept it. And boom, you're there. So interesting weekend for me, and certainly different than my other earlier years of Christmas, which were, you know, packages and snow and stuff like that. But anyhow, that's what I did. And again, I just hope that everyone else can have that opportunity to talk to not only your Christian friends, but your non-Christian friends, to be able to say, look, you know, what's next? Let me tell you something happy about what's next, and see where that goes. Anyhow, do I have more time?
As long as you want.
All right. Now for the more mundane stuff. Okay, I'm so I'm getting the Wall Street Journal these days, and I'm looking at the opinion section, and you know, the where everyone has a little bit of something to say, and I just open it up and I just start reading, and I see in hoc anno domini, which is in the year of our Lord. And I'm like, this should be interesting. I don't see this too often. And apparently, I don't read too many newspapers, as you will all see in a little bit. So it goes as follows. When Saul of Tarsus set out on his journey to Damascus, the whole of the known world lay in bondage. There was one state, and it was Rome. There was one master for it all, and it was Tiberius Caesar. Everywhere, there was civil order, for the arm of the Roman law was long. Everywhere there was stability in government and in society, for the centurion saw that it was so. But everywhere there was something else too. There was oppression for those who were not friends of Tiberius Caesar. Though there was the tax gatherers and the grain from the fields and the flax from the spindle of the feet to feed the legions or to fill the hungry treasures from which divine Caesar gave largesse to the people. There was the impressor to find recruits for the circuses. There were executioners to quiet those the emperor prescribed. There was a man, for what was a man but to serve Caesar? There was a perception of men who dared to think differently, who heard strange voices or read strange manuscripts. There was enslavement of men whose tribes came not from Rome, disdain for those who did not have the familiar visage. And most of all, there was everywhere a contempt for human life. What, to the strong, was one man more or less in a crowded world? Then, all of a sudden, there was light in the world. A man from Galilee saying, "Render unto Caesar the things which are Caesar's, and unto God things that are God's." And the voice from Galilee, which would defy Caesar, offered a new kingdom in which each man could walk upright and bow to none but his God. "It is much as ye have done it unto one of the least of these, my brothers, ye have done unto me." And he sent his gospel of the kingdom from man into the uttermost ends of the earth. So the light came into the world, and the men who lived in darkness were afraid. And they tried to lower a curtain so that man would still believe salvation lay with the leaders. But it came to pass for a while in diverse places that the truth did set men free. Although the men of darkness were offended and they tried to put out the light, the voice said, "Haste ye, walk while you have the light, lest darkness come upon you, for he that walketh in darkness knoweth not whither he goeth." Along the road to Damascus, the light shone brightly, but afterwards Paul of Tarsus too was sore afraid. He feared that other Caesars, other prophets, might one day persuade men that man was nothing save a servant unto them, that men might yield up their birthright from God for pottage and walk no more in freedom. Then might it come to pass that darkness would settle again over the lands, and there would be burning of books, and men would think only of what they should eat and what they should wear, and would give heed to only new Caesars and to false prophets. Then might it come to pass that men would not look upon upward to see even a winter's star in the east, and once more there would be no light at all in the darkness. And so Paul, the apostle of the Son of Man, spoke to his brethren, the Gentiles, the words he would have us remember afterwards in each of the years of his Lord. "Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage." So, this was written. I'm reading this, and I'm like going, whoever this guy is, I'm going to email him. I'm going to write him. I'm just going to say, thank you, thank you. This editorial was written in 1949 by the late Vermont Royster and has been published annually in the Wall Street Journal ever since, 58 years. And 1949, communism was present and feared for dictatorship, poverty, and oppression. So, hail to the Wall Street Journal for keeping a good thing alive. So, anyhow, there's my Christmas thing. You're welcome, dear. I love you, too. All right. Let's just have a quick prayer, and then we can get rolling here with Charlie. And Lord Jesus, thank you so much for this day, and particularly this season, because we so much love what you have done for us and told us about in your word, and obviously the path you provided to for each and every one of us who believe in you, to the eternity glory and beauty that we'll have with you. And regardless of whether that threshold comes in the form of our bodies failing or the rapture, but Lord, we know it is true, and your word is solid, and it proves itself solid every day. And Lord, just be with all of us today, and may we have the strength to talk to somebody else about Jesus, and may we just revel in the fact that you loved us so that you came here as a babe or a embryo or whatever you came in. We know it was the gift, and we know the gift is perfect, and Lord, we just praise you mightily because of it. And we pray all this in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen.